We're gonna clean the my fuel filter. So I'm really curious to see if we open it up, how bad it looks. I think it's gonna be pretty bad after all the bad fuel that I've been riding on. Good morning, internet. It is 8:43 in the morning and welcome back to the channel. Now, I've moved to an Airbnb, so I'm not staying in a hostel anymore because after one night staying in a dorm room with 7 strangers, I didn't get much sleep, so I moved to an Airbnb. And today I'm gonna go do 2 things. The first thing I'm gonna do is go to the Russian consulate to hopefully pick up my visa. I'll show you why, I'll show you on the map. Because I am now here in Almaty. And I'm heading towards this area. Now, my first plan was to go from Aktau and take a boat to Baku in Azerbaijan. But the thing is, to reach here, coming from Almaty, I have to follow this road. And I have to go all the way up here and then back down and then to Aktau. This road, I've heard from other travelers, is an absolute nightmare because it's still under construction. So other travelers said, do not take that road. So yeah, so that's the point. Just to go to Aktau, I have to make a massive detour. And when I was looking at the map, I thought, well, if I am here anyway, instead of going all the way down to Aktau, I might as well just cross through Russia into Georgia and then go this way. So I decided to apply for a Russian visa, and for me, applying for a Russian visa outside of the Netherlands is practically impossible for a normal tourist visa, but you can apply for a transit visa. So I did that. I filed my application here in Almaty, had to wait in line for 2 hours, but okay, I did it, and today, this morning, I can pick it up. And I don't know how much they will give me, probably a week or something, but that should be enough to cross that small part of Russia. And then, if I have my visa, then I'm gonna go to the KTM dealer. And why is that? Because I was looking on the website of Royal Enfield to see if they have support, and on the website it says they have a dealer in Kazakhstan, here in Almaty, which I contacted, but they actually... they're not really a Royal Enfield dealer. They do still give support for like classics, but they don't give any support for Himalayan. But he got me in touch with a good mechanic that works at KTM. So he's gonna have a look at the Santi. I already talked to them. I already dropped my spare tires there. So it's just a matter of going there and then get the service done. So it's gonna be a full day, I think. So yeah, let's go. So the Russian consulate is only 2 kilometers from where I'm staying here. So it's a short hop and then I'm already there. So I got my visa. Oh, it took 40 minutes and a lot of pushing and pulling, and they just have the weirdest system. Or, well, there's not really a system, and then sometimes they call somebody through the intercom and it's all in Russian and I didn't understand anything. So, but anyway, I kind of managed to get inside, and then it was a matter of a minute and I got my passport back with my visa. So yeah, let's go to the KTM dealer and get some work done on the Santi. So, I am at the KTM dealer. Ooh. Nice. Hi, how are you?
good? Do you want me to write it inside? So I will show you the parts that have to be replaced according to the service manual at 15,000 kilometers or 20,000 kilometers, which is some adapters, some pipe outlet, some, what is this, tube assay, and this is pipe comp engine oil, I don't know exactly, and some O-ring. So those need to be replaced. Nothing is broken, I don't have any problems, but yeah, with the kind of trip I'm doing, I think it's better to at least try to follow the service manual a little bit. And I've already been much overdue because I already did 22,000 kilometers. Anyway, and I also got some really awesome things from a company called Google Tech. They sent me some fuel filters. After seeing my videos that I was struggling with bad fuel in Uzbekistan and Tajikistan, they sent me these fuel filters, which I'm super happy with, because it should be, because I've been using a separate fuel filter, but it doesn't fit my tank. So I have to take it in and out all the time, and it stinks really badly of petrol, obviously. And I think this is probably the one that actually fits my tank. So that's really awesome. And then there's another filter which actually goes inside, how to say that, it's called an inline filter, I think, and it goes inside, so that filters directly before the petrol goes into the fuel injector, I believe. So that's even better probably to have that one. And then they also sent me this dry and I'll open it. They've sent me this is a washing line for drying clothes, but actually that comes with this bag. And this bag you can fit on the bike and then dry your clothes while riding. So that's actually a pretty cool gift as well. So I will definitely use that. But I'm mostly happy with the filters, because now I don't have to worry anymore about bad fuel. We're gonna clean my fuel filter. So I'm really curious to see if we open it up, how bad it looks. I think it's gonna be pretty bad after all the bad fuel that I've been riding on. So let's see. So as many of you have noticed, on this trip I've been riding in my old Ducati boots, and their condition doesn't look so good anymore. They're pretty damaged. Actually, when I was doing that border crossing from Tajikistan into Kyrgyzstan, and I was warming up in the customs office next to the stove, this boot actually got burned because it was standing a little bit too close to the stove. So yeah, it's just been time to get some new boots, because these were just finished. While I was here in the KTM shop, I checked some of the boots, and I bought myself these ones, which are from Axo Sport touring boots. So I don't know, I never heard of the brand before, but I hope they'll be good. They didn't have so much choice here, because I have a women's size foot, and yeah, well, most of the boots are all for men, and they're all like really big sizes. So I had a limited choice, but I think these boots will definitely get me until Europe. So that should be good. So I have a few more things for Basanti, a company called enfieldaccessories.co.uk, send me a couple of things which will be really helpful for my Basanti. So the link of these products, I'll put it in the video description. So if you're interested in getting it for your own Himalayan, then you can find it there. So basically it's three things. They sent me some proper brackets for my extra petrol cans, because this is kind of MacGyvered on there, made from like an old handlebar, so it's not very properly done. So they sent me some proper brackets, these ones, so they're much better attached. And then the second thing is they sent some super awesome carbon fender risers, so they will go here. So if I'm riding in thick mud, I'll have less chance of the mud getting stuck underneath the fender. So it's also really helpful. But mostly, the most important thing, I think, what they sent me is this phone holder. Because probably what you've noticed in my other videos is that my phone is completely blocking my... how you say that? My meters, so I cannot even see how fast I'm going or any of that. Because my phone holder was now here blocking all of this area. So with this new mount, it should be a lot better for me. And I can still look at my phone. Now, I get a lot of questions about what kind of navigation systems I'm using. I usually use both. Before, I was only using my phone and I didn't like it to rely only on my phone to have any idea where I was. So I decided to buy this Garmin GPS. But I still use my phone a lot because, for example, if I'm navigating within a city and I have to try and find a particular guest house or something like that, then my phone is much easier and I use an app which is called Maps Me, which works offline, so you don't need internet for it, which is great. And I also use my phone to pick my music, because I'm always listening to music inside my helmet, which is connected with Bluetooth to my phone. So that's why I like to have my phone handy somewhere, besides having my my Garmin. So that's that. Also, I get a lot of questions from people asking me, how do I find accommodation, especially in like more remote areas, like in Tajikistan and stuff. And for that I use an app called iOverlander, and this app also works offline, so you can download it once and you can find guest houses, you can find petrol stations where the border control or the control posts are, like all sorts of super helpful information that comes in handy on the road. I'll show you how the app looks like actually. So this is the app iOverlander, and basically, so for example, this is now Almaty, so you see all these places of interest. So you see where there's mechanics, where there's hostels, where there are embassies to get visas and all of that. So yeah, this is a super helpful app. If you're doing something like this, I can highly recommend downloading that app. So this is the new mount for my phone, and over here there's room for two USB cables, so I can charge my phone over there, which is good. The only thing I'm gonna do now is search for a new phone holder, because the one I was using was damaged anyway. I lost this rubber and it was actually damaging my phone, and it's not very handy to mount on this bar. So all I need to do is find another phone holder and then I'm all set. So Basanti is pretty much ready. I also changed my tires, finally. So about the tires, I've done 11,000 kilometers on that set of tires, which is exactly the same as I did on the original Indian tires that were on the bike when I bought it in Delhi. So the Pirelli MT60s, they lasted a lot longer or a lot better. So I could have actually done a couple of thousand kilometers more on these tires, which I would have done if I would just be at home riding around. But considering where I'm gonna go next, I've been looking at the map, and for me it was just much better to have a change here and not continue for much longer, because I'm gonna be riding like pretty remote again in Kazakhstan. So I decided to do it now. And they also did the valve check, and both the tappets, I don't know how to pronounce it, but they needed some adjusting. So it was about time to do that as well. I've now done 22,000 kilometers on Basanti, so valve check is also done, so that's good for me. So
I'm now gonna try and find a shop for a new phone holder. Let's see if we can find that somewhere. So, I found a new phone holder. As you can see, I found it here in this shop called Pro Sport here in Almaty. So it's just mounted here like that. So looks pretty good, I think. I hope it will stay in place when I'm riding off-road and stuff, but we'll see.
So that was it for today. I'm really happy with all the work that got done on Basanti. I was thinking about that fuel filter, and I think it's pretty incredible that Basanti was actually still running and that the fuel pump was still working, because it was really, really bad. But anyway, Basanti did it, and now it's all clean. Plus I have the extra Googletech filters, so I don't think I have to worry about bad fuel anymore, which is really nice. I also don't have to worry about my tires anymore. They're good to go for a very long time. And I'm also quite glad that I don't have to drag them on and off every day anymore. And it will also save me a lot of weight. So Basanti is going to be much lighter, which is nice. I'm going to have a lot of riding coming, because my Russian transit visa will start in 2 weeks, less than 2 weeks from now. And I have to cover more than 3,400 kilometers to reach the border. So for me, that's a lot of riding in 2 weeks. So tomorrow I'm planning to ride 600 kilometers, which is probably the longest. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's the longest ride I've done so far, if I manage to cover 600 kilometers. I don't know, I'm gonna try anyway. See how it goes. So yeah, I really hope you liked this video. If you did, please give me a big thumbs up and subscribe down below. And stay tuned for the next video, because that is going to be a very, very long ride through Kazakhstan.